Good evening. I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, and this is the Medical Explorer. As a specialist in skin diseases and allergies, and as host of this program, I will take you on an exploration of the medical communities of our Northern California counties and bring you behind the scenes of medical care practices right here in our local areas. Tonight, the Medical Explorer will take you behind the closed doors of the vascular surgery operating rooms of Damron Hospital in Stockton, as we meet again with one of Northern California's most respected surgeons, Dr. Alan Coulson. This evening, Dr. Coulson will show us a technique that has prevented strokes in thousands of Americans during the past decade. Tonight, Dr. Coulson will show us actual carotid artery surgery as he removes a dangerous blockage from the main artery that supplies blood to the brain. We will have the chance to witness the removal of a cholesterol plaque that could have cut off the brain's blood supply at any time and caused a stroke and even death if it had not been removed. This is the first time that this procedure has been shown on local television, and the view is fascinating. In the pharmacy corner tonight, our award-winning neighborhood pharmacist, Bob Church, will tell us about the many over-the-counter topical nasal decongestants which have been promoted to make breathing easier if you suffer from nasal stuffiness. Are these easy to obtain nasal decongestants as safe and effective as their manufacturers say? Well, we'll learn the answer to this question and others about nasal decongestants in the pharmacy corner tonight. Tonight's program will be extremely timely and informative, and I hope that you'll stay with us for the next half hour. Before getting to our topics tonight, I'd like to discuss a disturbing trend that has been reported to me from viewers in this community in letters from my mail and in personal communications. It was also presented on a recent CBS News program, Street Stories with Ed Bradley. This is the trend of patients being told that they cannot see a specialist for their health care. Due to the high cost of health insurance, many employers have been forced to switch from traditional health insurance plans to health plans that have a greater number of restrictions on where a patient may receive their care. These newer plans require all care to be given from one doctor before a patient may seek the advice of a specialist. Although most doctors refer their patients to specialists very early in their treatment if there appears to be a need for another opinion, a small number of practitioners refuse to refer their patients to specialists even when all other treatments have failed. One example reported to me was a 45-year-old woman who was losing the use of her arms and legs. She was becoming increasingly paralyzed. Treatments from her main doctor were not working, and they couldn't figure out an explanation about the reason why she was becoming paralyzed. When she asked to be referred to a specialist, her primary care doctor refused. She was told that they could do everything that the specialist could do. Finally, when the patient felt that she was getting worse and worse, she made an appointment on her own with a nerve specialist. This highly trained expert immediately made the diagnosis of polio, a rare nerve infection that can affect people who were not adequately immunized in the past. With the fast diagnosis and treatment from the nerve specialist, she recovered fully without any permanent paralysis. Unfortunately, she's still having the difficulty getting her health plan to pay for the treatment because she couldn't get the referral from her primary doctor. I am pleased to report that the majority of primary care doctors in our community are ready and willing to refer their patients to a specialist before things get totally out of control or if the patient requests a specialty referral. However, there are a few physicians that wait much too long before they refer their patients to specialty care experts that they may need. If you have concerns about wanting to see a specialist for your medical care, you shouldn't be afraid to bring them to the attention of your primary care doctor. You should speak up and ask. You should also investigate the rules or restrictions of any new health plan as you or your employer consider signing up. Ask about your rights to see a specific doctor or specialist for your care. It's now time for us to visit our pharmacy corner as we learn the latest up-to-date information on the world of drugs and medications from one of our area's most respected neighborhood pharmacists. Returning tonight in our pharmacy corner is award-winning pharmacist Bob Church from the Medicine Shop Pharmacy in Marysville. Bob, welcome back to the Medical Explorer.
Thank you.
The most common causes of nasal stuffiness, I suppose, are having a cold or airborne allergies. Could you tell us about the manner in which a patient may try to help the stuffiness problem?
Well, I think basically what people try, they look at two things. They look at internal medicines that can be taken by mouth to relieve their symptoms, or they turn all too frequently to what I call topical nasal decongestants, drops, sprays, those types of things which they use topically instead of internally.
Tell us about some of these. What are some of the different products?
Okay. Basically, these products work by affecting certain receptors within the nasal mucosa and causing vasoconstriction. The vasoconstriction is then associated with a shrinking of the nasal passages, and you get more air through, and you can breathe better.
Why these versus a pill? Why wouldn't someone just take it?
Well, I think basically people look to these products for two reasons. They work very rapidly, within 10 to 15 minutes, and they're normally associated with less side effects than some of the internal medicines. So I think those are the two main reasons people turn to those products.
Can you tell us about some specific products?
Yeah, there are nasal sprays. I'm sure people are familiar with things like Afrin, Neo-synephrine, Otrivin, Vicks nasal inhaler. So you have the sprays, you have drops, and you have little plastic inhalers where the medication is actually on a wick with inside the inhaler.
I know in my work in allergy diseases, people often come in here who have used these nasal sprays, as an example, Afrin and Neosinephrine, for years, and they get addicted to them.
Absolutely.
They can't stop using them. And you look into their nose, and the inside of their nose looks like you poured battery acid in there. It's cracking, it's dried out, it's a total mess.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess one of the problems is you can get hooked on it.
Yes, you can. That's called rebound congestion, and that is the main drawback to those products, any of those products.
I see. Does that apply to things like Vicks, you know, that you may put on your chest with a cold and things like that?
No, not to those, but it does apply to the ones which you put actually internally into your nose.
I see.
Absolutely.
Boy, what about some other advantages or disadvantages about these?
Well, I think there are some advantages and disadvantages to each one of the dosage forms. For the sprays, obviously, they put the medication into a very small particle size, so as you inhale it, it covers the nasal mucosa very nicely. Those are good for older children and adults, not for infants. The drops are good for infants because of the size of their nasal passages are so small that those seem to be ideal. The inhalers, like the Vicks inhaler, the drawback to those is that after you open them, they really only last for 2 to 3 months at most because they evaporate so rapidly. And also, you have to have a good airflow to be able to ingest those vapors through your nose to get any relief from those products.
How does someone choose a product for themselves? What's the right way to look at it?
Well, I think you have to look at, first of all, what their medical condition is, their overall medical condition, because if you're going to use a nasal spray on somebody with vascular or heart problems, you want to be very careful. You don't want to use a long-term nasal spray, like something with Afrin that is good for 12 hours. If they have side effects to a spray, you want to be using a short-term spray so that in 2-3 hours those problems are gone. You want to look at whether they have infection, they have any discharge, colored discharge when they blow their nose.
Yellow or green material, pussy
right.
material, things
Definitely.
Like that. Right.
There are times when people need to determine what their course of therapy is through their physician and not just take one of these sprays or drops off the counter and use them. You want to make sure that you never use them more than twice a day and no longer than 4 days.
That's a real important point. I bet you must see occasionally in your pharmacy people coming in week after week buying these things.
There's no doubt about that.
Do you try to talk to them about it?
I do, and you know, you get to a point, some of these people have been doing this for years, literally years, and they're going to buy those products irregardless of whether they buy them in my pharmacy or somebody else's pharmacy. So all I can really do is try and support the fact that they need to try and wean themselves off of these, that there are good, credible ways to do that, and that they can be successful if they seek the help that they need.
Right. They're very safe cortisone-related nose sprays that we've talked about on previous programs that are prescriptions
mm-hmm.
that can be used to turn that addiction right off.
Right.
There are also internal medicines that have cortisone in them that can calm that inflammation down and get them away from that too.
Sure.
So if people can get to their doctor, there's ways to stop that.
Definitely.
But even myself, I know if I have a cold and I'm all stuffed up, I'll certainly use them for 2 or 3 days without any question about
Absolutely.
That. You just have to remember that when you're ready to stop, you got to get off that thing and get back to your normal way. That's
Definitely.
True. Bob, as usual, that was very useful information, and I hope our viewers will discuss their concerns regarding nasal stuffiness with their pharmacists and physicians very soon. We look forward to you returning to the Pharmacy Corner on future programs.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure, Bob. Thank you. Now, on with the Medical Explorer. Have you ever suffered from sudden weakness on one side of your body where you feel that you have lost control of an arm or a leg? Although these symptoms can be a sign of many problems, it's possible that you might be suffering from a blockage in your carotid artery in your neck. Today, it's quite common for patients to undergo surgery to remove these blockages. This evening, with the gracious invitation of Dr. Alan Coulson and the well-respected Damron Hospital in Stockton, we will actually get a chance to see the procedure that allows surgeons to save lives every day. I'd like to reintroduce you to vascular chest and heart surgeon, Dr. Alan Coulson. Welcome back to Yuba City in our Medical Explorer studios. Our viewers know that you've been on previous programs. You've shown us heart surgery. We know about your excellent qualifications in heart surgery, and chest surgery, vascular surgery. So if you don't mind, we won't go back into all of that today, but our focus will be on carotid artery surgery. Now, everyone knows the carotid artery is in the neck, and it's a very important blood vessel, but most of our viewers don't really know what would go wrong, what they would feel if their carotid artery was plugging up. What might they feel?
They might experience what's called a TIA, a transient ischemic attack, where they would have numbness or weakness of the hand, for example, where they couldn't hold a teacup or they couldn't turn a doorknob, lasting for a few minutes and going away, or weakness or numbness of the leg or the side of the face. Sometimes transient blindness, with it, like a curtain falling over the eye and rising again. These are warnings of serious carotid artery disease. Sometimes the patient's asymptomatic, and the doctor picks it up by listening and hearing a bruit, a noise over the artery, as the blood is running over that diseased segment. Or they may have a stroke, which would be the thing you're trying to avoid.
I see. So you try prevention, but sometimes you have to do things after the fact.
After the fact, yes.
How does a patient get to you, though, as you're being a very specialist or person in this area? Do you usually get them sent to you, or how does that work?
Yes, most of them are sent to me from neurologists or from internists who heard the noise in the neck and have done an ultrasound test where they've seen the disease by using sound waves. And they come to me to have arrangements for the x-ray, the arteriograms, to make a road map of the artery in the neck and also up higher in the brain to make sure there's no other diseases further up.
I see. Well, I know that you're going to show us this on your patient tonight, so rather than wait any further, I really want to see what's going on. So why don't we leave our Medical Explorer studio here and travel back down Interstate 5 to Stockton and Damron Hospital as we continue the Medical Explorer from Damron Hospital.
This is a sideways view of a patient's neck, and the diamond is pointing to the jaw for orientation. The white, the top left-hand screen is the teeth. The long white tubes are the arteries in the neck going to the brain, the internal carotid artery, and down here is the bulb area. And the diamond is pointing to an area of disease where you can see a blackish area pointing into the side of the artery. This is the stenosis or narrowing. This is the area where the blood is turbulent, it's held up, and blood clots can form in ulcer pockets in that area.
So this would be done with the help of a radiologist?
The radiologist takes the pictures, and we get these pictures back to plan the surgery.
Very good. So they would inject a dye into the artery for that.
Right.
What happens next? You have that information.
We discuss the surgery with the patient, and then all, if they're agreeable, understand the surgery, we proceed to the operation, which shows on the next scene, shows us opening up the neck.
Well, let's take a look.
This is the left-hand side of the neck. The patient's head is to the right-hand side of the screen, the feet to the left-hand side. The muscle is the sternomastoid at the bottom of the screen, and there's a retractor spreading that muscle and skin apart.
Now, this is a general anesthetic procedure. The patient's put to sleep. He or she doesn't feel anything at this point.
Exactly, yes.
So it's sterilized. There's a team working around you, and you're all set to go. You've entered that. You're below the skin, and you're about ready to get to the artery, I understand.
I'm going to go on now to expose the artery. The next scene shows that. This is the main common carotid artery in the neck, and we're going to pass a white plastic tape around that to control it. And once that tape is around there, the dissection proceeds further to the right of the screen to expose the branch, the bifurcation, where the common carotid artery divides into an internal and external branch. The internal goes to the brain, the external goes to the side of the face.
So you're there, you have a material that looks a little elastic that actually lifts the artery without injuring the artery.
It's very gentle, yes.
I would think that you have to be extremely gentle there. You wouldn't want to nick it or do anything.
Or dislodge some clot. If you shake the artery too much, you could knock some calcium or clot loose, and that would be a disaster.
Oh, I see. Well, very good. Let's continue.
Now we've dissected out the branches. I'm pointing here to the thyroid branch coming off the external. This is the internal now, going to the brain. That's the bulb area. And on the left of the screen is the common carotid artery you saw earlier. And there's the nerve to the tongue, the hypoglossal nerve, which we're very careful to preserve that so we don't get tongue paralysis.
Well, this is very important because you, number one, have the main artery from the heart to the brain right in front of us. Mm. You have a branch going toward the face, the control of the muscles for the face, the whole blood supply for the face. Mm. And if any nerve or injury could occur there, the person might lose the motion of the tongue or
yes,
other things.
So exactly. You have to be very careful what we're doing here.
That's why surgeons such as yourself go to school for so many years. Was it 5 years after medical school or even longer to do these things?
Yeah, more like 8 years.
Eight years after medical school. It's an incredible amount of time. Yeah. Let's continue.
This is an ultrasound picture taken in the operating room. This is a new technology we have. We can show the dampening. That waveform is dampened, indicating disease in that internal carotid artery, confirming what we've seen on the arteriograms earlier.
So using sound waves, you can see where the blockage is.
The big advance is having this capacity actually in the operating room now. So we can check our work at the end, as you'll see, to prove that we've done a good job, got it all nice and clean, and left no residual blockage.
I see. Same principle as a woman who has a baby would look with ultrasound at that too, I understand.
Now we're opening up the artery with a pair of scissors, opening up the internal carotid artery. You can see we're struggling to cut through that calcium which is in the wall of the artery, and the sucker is coming in to suck out some blood. And gradually we get that whole artery opened up in preparation to put in the special shunt, which I brought along to the studio tonight so that the viewers could see how it looks, the actual shunt we put into the artery. There's the yellow calcium and cholesterol inside the artery, which is the cause of the disease.
Now, in order for you to have that artery opened, you've closed off the artery, is that
temporarily
correct?
Temporarily clamped it above and below, yes.
So for a short period of time, there's no blood
there's
going
no
to that side of the
going
person's
to the brain. So we have to move expeditiously to get the shunt in, yes.
Well, you brought with you an interesting device that shows how the blood can go around the surgery area.
Exactly. This is a new Pruitt shunt. Which is
I
a big
hold that up so they can get the camera see.
This is a new Pruitt shunt, which is a big advance in carotid artery surgery. This tube, this clear plastic tube, is where the blood goes from the heart to the brain. We put this balloon into the common carotid artery and inflate it to stop blood leaking around it. Blood can then run along this in tube here to the brain, and this balloon is inflated so it doesn't leak back. So these two balloons give you a clear field to work in. And this is a side valve, so we can watch the blood bouncing to prove that it's circulating while we're working. So this new Pruitt shunt has been a major advance in this surgery.
Before you start this surgery, do you have to be certain that the person has a good circulation from the other side to make sure that they will get blood flow for that short time?
Some patients don't have the other carotid artery, so we have to move fast. We measure our time in seconds.
Do you actually time it as you're
yes,
doing it?
Yes, the nurses will run a stopwatch. And we also give steroids to help cut down the edema.
Oh, boy, so
you're the main thing is technically moving fast.
Because as we watch this, everything seems so controlled, so calm, so organized, but in the back of your mind, you know that you have to do that fast enough so that blood keeps circulating through the brain.
Exactly, yeah.
Great. Well, why don't we keep going on and see what's next?
Here's the tube being inserted into the internal carotid artery now, and make sure it's safely in position. A little clamp is put in so that balloon doesn't slide backwards. And then the other end, the blood's allowed to run back from the brain for a few seconds just to flush the air out so there's no air bubbles. And then you'll see the other end of the tube has been put into the common carotid artery. So that patient's brain is now being fed with blood, and we can all relax because the shunt is in place. But for a few seconds, as you say, we have to move fast to get that tube in smoothly and cleanly. And there's a good view showing the shunt, the Pruitt shunt, in place. On the left-hand side of the screen, the common carotid artery, the loop of plastic tubing feeding to the right-hand side into the internal carotid artery.
So without that flow through that plastic tube, there wouldn't be blood getting to that person's
exactly,
brain.
Exactly, yes, and it would be at risk.
Very good.
Now we're cleaning out the calcium plaque, the atherosclerotic plaque, with a little dissector, a freer. We preserve the artery wall to the top of the screen, and that a little plug, or like a little bullet almost, of calcium and cholesterol is being carefully cleaned away from the artery wall. We're developing a plane, and we'll gradually get that whole solid three-dimensional bullet out of the artery and the branch, the external, going to the face as well.
Is there an average for how old a person would be before this plaque forms?
Usually we see patients in their 60s, late 50s, 60s, and 70s. It's, you know, it's the usual pattern as far as age group goes.
Do you think, in your opinion, that people taking drugs to lower their cholesterol or helping their diet to decrease cholesterol or increasing exercise might decrease their risk of getting these plaques?
Very much so, yes.
You do feel that way?
All the risk factors, if you can modify them, that will help, yes.
I think even smoking can make this worse, so stopping smoking is very important.
Exactly, yes.
Very good. Well, let's continue.
Now you can see we've going to cut with a pair of special scissors to get the bottom end of the plaque. That's my hand obscuring the view. I'm so apologize. I couldn't get my hand totally out of the way all the time. But what I'm doing is cutting the bottom end of that plaque from the common carotid artery. And there's a little special little sucker so I can see what I'm doing all the time there.
So that shiny yellowish red material there is the plaque, it's cholesterol, calcium.
Exactly, yes. And then we're going to now pull it out of the external carotid artery, and then we clamp to squeeze it out. It's like forcing it out of that tube, and then you'll see it, again, my hand's blocking the view, I apologize. You'll see us lifting the whole thing out in one big continuous piece. There's a tail of it coming out now.
That's amazing.
So there's the artery cleaned out, and the next step you'll see in a few seconds, we're going to put a stitch to make sure that the top end of the lining of the artery does not lift up when the blood starts to run up there. So I sew down the top end of the artery as a security. We put a very fine stitch as a layer so that that inner lining doesn't dissect away when the blood hits it under high pressure.
I see.
Okay. As a precaution. After that, I put a patch, and the next scene after this will show us sewing a vein patch. We take a piece of vein from the leg and make an oval patch, and you'll see in a few minutes where that patch is.
Why is that necessary?
It widens the artery so that if in the future disease ever comes back, which it mostly doesn't, it won't narrow the artery in the patient's lifetime.
Oh.
And also, the patch prevents you narrowing the artery. If you were to just close the artery directly, you would narrow it. But by putting this patch on, you finish up with a wider, normal size or wider artery.
So
this is a piece of saphenous vein taken from the patient's thigh where the vein can be taken without any harm to the patient. And this is tailored into an oval shape and sewn with lots, about 50 or 60 small stitches down each side.
Very tedious manual dexterity type procedure there. You have to keep working very hard on
that. And
that's
just finishing up the job. Now you'll see the whole oval shape is almost completed.
Is it like a graft? I mean,
it's a graft of vein taken from the leg and replaced onto this artery, where the artery opening was. There'll come a point now where we have to take that shunt out, and again, we have to work fast to finish off the suture line, another point of drama where that shunt will be taken out and the artery clamped, and then we have to sew fast and accurately to make sure that we don't damage the brain, but also do a good job so it doesn't leak afterwards.
Right, so where those little holes where the plastic tubing is going through, you can't just pull it out and hold it closed. You have to be sure that that's closed well with the suturing.
Oh, yes.
So there's a time period where, the blood's interrupted.
The blood's interrupted, and again, you're talking, we measure it in seconds as we do this.
Very
good. We'll show in the next scene, we'll show us washing it now with antibiotic solution to get the blood off, and then expeditiously completing the suture line.
How long would this type of surgery take on a normal situation?
It takes about 2 hours.
Oh, 2 hours.
Do the whole thing.
We're condensing it into 10 minutes here.
Well, we've left out quite a lot of the early dissection, which is
getting down to the artery.
Down to right. It, yeah.
Right.
And here we are putting in the final stitches now, about 5 or 6 stitches to complete the patch in place. All the air has to be out also. We don't want any air bubbles to go up to the brain. So we also have to back bleed, let all the air out, make sure there's no bits of calcium left.
So we understand why you really have to be totally aware of everything that's going on and have that excellent background that you do as a surgeon.
You have to concentrate hard, yes.
Right. Very good.
And there's the patch completed, and this is the atherosclerotic plaque that we took out.
It's amazing. We should think about that as people worry about their cholesterol and blood pressure and smoking and what happens.
I'm pointing now to the external carotid artery. Mm-hmm. This is the internal carotid artery. And at the base, there are these ulcerated areas where blood clots form. And these blood clots can break loose and go up and hit the brain and cause the TIA episodes or small strokes. So that irregular oval area in the middle there is like a crater. And that's an ulcer in the atherosclerotic plaque. And there's the common carotid artery further down there. But that's a source of danger right there. Quite apart from the narrowing, the irregularity, see, the blood clots can break loose and go to the brain.
Right. This is what plaques would look like in other parts of the body where cholesterol and calcium plug up areas
too. Very similar. The femoral artery or in the heart coronary artery is very similar, yes.
Right. Yeah. Now, what did you do next?
And here's a view. What the blood would see is it's trying to go to the brain. It's coming up there, and it's just a little pinhole
to get through there.
So the blood supply really is difficult to get to the brain. The last scene shows the ultrasound picture of the artery. After we've cleaned it out, and you'll see there's a much better waveform now, a normal waveform.
So you're verifying that blood is now flowing very well through that artery.
Sure, and we're doing it with the neck open in the operating room, which is a big advance. We can actually check our work right there, and if there's any doubts about it, we can look into it right away.
That's just fascinating. I really want to thank you very much for sharing this with us tonight. I'd also like to make sure that we thank the operating room staff at Damron Hospital in Stockton for allowing the medical explorer to view actual carotid endarterectomy procedures. If patients have questions about this, would they bring that to their general doctor first, do you think?
Yeah, that's the best thing, is to go to your family physician or internist first, then to be referred by your family doctor to screen and evaluate the patient first.
And neurologists often do a lot of that,
neurologists
too.
Neurologists often do it. They see a lot of this, and they do an excellent job.
Great, very good. The medical explorer looks forward to returning to Stockton and Damron Hospital with Dr. Coulson as he continues our exploration of his fascinating field of heart, vascular, thoracic surgery. Thank you again. This has just been incredible.
Well, thank you very much for allowing me to be here.
Oh,
thank you.
It's a pleasure. Well, that's our program for tonight. I'd like to invite you to write to me at my dermatology and allergy office in Yuba City with your suggestions for areas and people that you'd like to see on this program. I'm always interested in hearing from you, and I hope that you'll suggest to your medical doctor or other healthcare professional that you'd like to see them here with me on the Medical Explorer. We are a public service program, and I really do want to hear from you with your comments and suggestions. Please write to me at the Skin and Allergy Medical Group of Yuba City at 350 Del Norte Avenue, Yuba City, 95991. In my next program, The Medical Explorer will take you behind the scenes of more interesting frontiers of medical care practices in the Yuba City, Marysville, and Stockton areas. Till next time, I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, your Medical Explorer. Thank you for joining us tonight, and have a good evening.